We discussed in a previous video everything you need to know about cardiac action potentials, and I'll link that above. We use that simple catchphrase to remember the different phases along with the ion channels that were involved. For the non-pacemaker cardiac myocytes, including those of the atria and ventricles that lead to contraction, we use the summit, plummet, continue, plummet catchphrase. And then for the pacemaker cells, including those of the SA node and AV node that lead to conduction, we use the climb and plummet catchphrase. I highly recommend you go check this video out. It will help make more sense of antiarrhythmics and how they work. So let's now move on to antiarrhythmics. There are four main class types that you need to know, and the way to remember this is using this mnemonic, some block potassium channels. You're going to use the first letter in each word to remember each class type. So some is going to help you remember that sodium channel blockers are class 1. Block will help you remember that beta blockers are class 2. Class 3 are potassium channel blockers. And lastly, class 4 are calcium channel blockers. Let's first start off with sodium channel blockers. So where in the action potential did we say that sodium channels were involved? We said that they were involved in phase 0 of the non-pacemaker cardiac myocytes. These were the myocytes of the atrium ventricles that led to contraction. And when an action potential was generated, the sodium ion channels opened, creating an influx of sodium into the cell, making the cell more positive, leading to depolarization. Well, if we block those sodium channels, then sodium's not going to be able to get into the cell, and the cell's going to have a harder time becoming more positive and depolarizing. As you can see in the image, this will decrease the slope of phase 0 and ultimately decrease the amplitude and rate of depolarization. This will decrease the excitability of the cell and serve to suppress abnormal conduction rhythms. Now you can see in the action potential of the SA node and AV node that sodium channels are not involved in depolarization and repolarization. It's calcium and potassium that's involved. And for that reason, class 1 antiarrhythmics really don't have much effect on the SA node and AV node and those of the pacemaker cells like the other antiarrhythmics do. And we'll see that here shortly. This is also why sodium channel blockers are good to treat those reentry tachyarrhythmias that if we block the AV node, that could be deleterious. So in summary, sodium channel blockers are going to block phase 0 of the non-pacemaker cardiac myocytes. These are the atrial ventricular myocytes that lead to contraction. One more thing to note with sodium channel blockers is that there are three subclasses, class 1A, 1B, 1C. I have a great video that gives you a simple way to remember the different subclasses of sodium channel blockers, and I'll link that above. I encourage you to go check that out. We're going to skip beta blockers for a moment because they don't involve ion channels directly, and we're going to talk about potassium channel blockers. So where in the action potential did we say that potassium channels were involved? We said that they're involved in phase 3 of both the non-pacemaker myocytes and the pacemaker myocytes. Phase 3 was involved in repolarization of the cell. This is when the potassium ion channels are open, leading to an efflux of potassium out of the cell, making the cell more negative, leading to repolarization. Well, if we block those potassium ion channels, the potassium is going to have a harder time exiting the cell, and the cell is going to have a harder time becoming more negative and repolarizing. So this is going to prolong the repolarization phase of both the non-pacemaker cells and the pacemaker cells. As a result, both action potential duration and effective refractory period are going to be increased. This will decrease the excitability of the non-pacemaker cardiac myocytes, including those of the atrium ventricles that lead to contraction. It's also going to decrease conduction velocity of the pacemaker cells. And together, this will help suppress some of those tachyarrhythmias. So in summary, potassium channel blockers are going to block phase 3 of action potentials of both the non-pacemaker myocytes as well as the pacemaker myocytes. Let's now move on to calcium channel blockers. So where in the action potential do we say that calcium channels were involved in? We said that they were involved in phase 2 of the non-pacemaker cardiac myocytes as well as phase 0 of the pacemaker myocytes. Starting with phase 2 of the non-pacemaker cardiac myocytes, this is when the calcium ion channels were open, leading to an influx of calcium into the cell, resulting in contraction of the cell. This is when the atrium ventricles were contracting. Well, if we block the ability of calcium to enter the cell, then there's going to be decreased cardiac contraction of those atrium ventricular myocytes, and this will help suppress those dysrhythmias. Calcium channel blockers also have effects on the SA node and AV node. They're going to prevent influx of calcium, which would normally depolarize the cell, which is going to lead to decreased amplitude and rate of depolarization. This is going to decrease the automaticity of the SA node, as well as decrease conduction velocity through the AV node. And together, that will also help suppress the tachyarrhythmias. So in summary, calcium channel blockers are going to block phase 2 of the non-pacemaker cardiac myocytes that lead to contraction, and they're going to block phase 0 of the pacemaker cells, including the SA node and AV node, that would normally lead to depolarization. The final class of antiarrhythmics to discuss is class 2, which are the beta blockers. So beta blockers do not act specifically on ion channels, but they do act on beta receptors. Remember that the sympathetic nervous system releases catecholamines such as norepinephrine and epinephrine that act on beta receptors in the heart to increase heart rate and cardiac contraction. Well, beta blockers are going to block these beta receptors. So starting with contraction first, they will bind to beta 1 adrenergic receptors in the non-pacemaker cells of the atrium ventricles that lead to contraction. This will block that phase 2. We know that's the contraction part of the action potential. And in doing so, this will decrease cardiac contraction. Beta blockers also function to decrease heart rate. They do this by blocking beta 1 adrenergic receptors in the conduction system that will block phase 4 of the pacemaker cells. This was that quote-unquote resting phase where the cells slowly became more positive until another action potential was generated. Well, if we block that phase, then it's going to decrease the firing of action potentials and decrease the frequency of depolarization and repolarization, and this will ultimately decrease heart rate. And together, decreased heart rate and decreased cardiac contraction will help suppress some of those tachyarrhythmias. So in summary, beta blockers will block phase 2 of non-pacemaker cells and block phase 4 of pacemaker cells.